尊敬桂官諾儀博士，各位嘉賓朋友，包括線上邊觀賞緊我哋直播嘅講座嘅朋友，傳媒朋友，下午好。咁首先啦，好感謝大家喺百忙之中啦，都出席我哋今次文房雅趣呢個講座啦。Catherine，首先我介紹一下自己先。 咁我本人咧係澳門古玩古典家具商會嘅理事長，中國根嘅總經理啦，以及係清華大學蘇富比藝術學院藝術管理學碩士。咁而坐我身邊嘅就係馮連華先生啦，咁佢就係澳門古玩古典家具商會嘅主席，中國根嘅行政總裁，亦都係一位非常之資深嘅澳門古玩收藏家。 從事古玩行業都超過30年㗎啦，咁今日咧，我哋都帶嚟咗4件我哋嘅私人收藏啦，嚟同大家分享嘅。咁希望大家咧係接住落嚟呢個鐘啦，可以放低手頭上嘅工作啦，拋開一啲生活嘅繁瑣，將自己融入到一個文人嘅生活當中啦，好好咁享受藝術為你哋帶嚟嘅美好。 咁喺度啦，都好感謝啦，官諾儀基金會啦，對我哋講座嘅支持啦，特別係官諾儀博士對中國傳統文化啦嘅一啲嘅弘揚同埋貢獻。咁等我哋咧有機會可以俾更多澳門嘅朋友可以了解到中國傳統嘅藝術，提供一個平台俾大家做一個互動嘅。咁我都首先 recap 一下啦。等先，
馮小姐，我需要翻㗎啦。
我啲時候我要譯㗎。好。今日咧都為大家準備咗一個同傳翻譯嘅。你等一陣，我睇下而家在座有冇人需要。如果冇，可以唔譯住咯。好。係啊。
你有冇需要？在座有冇人需要英文 ？So does anyone here need interpreting service? Because I will be translating the speaker's content into English. Yes. Yes. Or because as said by the speaker, if no one here needs English interpreting service, then maybe we can wait until an English speaker comes. Okay. All right.
And do the translation.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to our talk on Literati Elegance, J Scholars Objects Introduction. I want to thank you, especially want to thank Mr. Rui Cunha and his fund for organizing this talk. And so my name is Catherine. I am Fong Mei Leng, Catherine Fong. I am the director of Macau Antique and Furniture Chamber of Commerce, general manager of Old House Gallery. And I also have a master's degree in art business at Tsinghua University and Sotheby Institute of Art. Sitting next to me is Mr. Fong Lin Wa. Okay, he's the chairman of Macau Antique and Furniture Chamber of Commerce and also CEO of Old House Gallery. He's also Macau Chinese Senior Antique Collector. He has more than 30 years experience in Chinese antique and furniture industry. So our talk will last about 1 hour today. I hope that you can enjoy this talk and can feel the world of ancient literati. And so that we can also spread Chinese culture and let more Macau people know about this very special Chinese culture.
咁我都 recap 翻啦，其實文房雅趣咧係我哋一系列嘅講座嚟嘅。 咁其實咩係文房呢？咁其實文房咧係一個好廣泛嘅概念嘅。從字面上嘅解釋啦，我哋可以話文房係文人一個書齋啦，一個書房啦，到後嚟咧慢慢引申到咧去一啲文房嘅用具嘅。咁其實文人咧對書房嘅擺設咧都非常之講究嘅喎。咁咧佢哋嘅書房咧就唔在乎華麗，但係咧就係為咗要表達自己嘅內心嘅情感。 咁咧係一種精神嘅寄託嚟嘅，係表達咗咧對當時社會嘅一啲嘅感受。好啦，咁我都同大家分享一下啦，玉同埋中國嘅一個古文化啦。咁自古以嚟咧，其實我哋咧中國人咧都對玉咧係充滿咗敬意嘅喎，我哋敬重玉，第一係喺一個精神上邊。 古人咧幾千年前咧就發現咗咧一個好靚嘅美石啦，無論你係放喺手入邊定係你掛喺身上，隨之而嚟嘅其實都係一種精神嘅力量。咁第二咧就喺道德上面，古人敬重玉，唔因為佢珍貴，唔單止因為珍貴，係因為佢有高潔嘅品德。我哋所以將玉咧提升到去一個審美嘅高度。 其實咧，而家我哋譬如睇好多古裝電視劇啊，大家都會見到咧，我哋古人啊都會戴住玉嘅喎，咁尤其係讀書人、文人啦，同埋一啲朝廷嘅高官啦，佢哋都會戴玉。 咁咧，追溯翻個根源咧，其實我哋喺紅衫文化、梁柱時期啊，就已經有古玉佩戴嘅呢種傳統。
Okay, so actually we are going to organize a series of talks on this topic, and by 文房, okay, in Cantonese, in English it means the study of an educated person or an intelligent person, but later this meaning extends to include the stationery or the tools used or you can find in a study. So in the past, Chinese people really had high requirements for the setting in their study because it showed how they felt and also their spirituality. And when we talk about jade, it is inseparable from Chinese culture. Chinese people respect jade because it carries their how they feel spiritually. And when you hold a jade piece in your hand, okay, or even you just carried it on your body, you can feel the power given by jade. Chinese people also worship or respect jade because it is a symbol of virtue and integrity. If you watch Chinese TV dramas in ancient Chinese setting, you can always see they would carry a piece of jade, especially educated class and officials, they would carry jade items. And in the Hongshan era and also Liangshu era, carrying jade was also very popular.
相信大家都有聽過君子無故玉不去身呢句説話啦。咁其實佢咩意思呢？就係話我哋君子啊都會帶住一嚿玉㗎，就好似同人哋講我帶咗玉㗎啦，我係君子嚟㗎，咁樣證明自己咧嘅品德咧同埋人格，咁亦都咧成為當時一時嘅風尚嘅。
多得官啊！邀請你咪講先，用個咪講。
Dr. Cunha 今日都過咗嚟啦，咁所以我哋都邀請Dr. Cunha上前嚟，同我哋都係啦，俾啲掌聲。For the meeting, final. Thanks for coming. Should we have another group photo first, maybe?
Take it.
或者我哋都影一影張合照先啦，因為大家今日而家都好齊人，唔好意思啊，打斷咗你哋。
好，再影。影相係好重要嘅，因為好一陣有啲仙草。
And other photo from the phone. Okay, thanks. So we will continue. 咁啦，啱啱就講到咧，君子無故玉不去身啦。咁其實我哋仲有一句説話喎，叫做君子彼得如玉。咁係咩意思呢？即係話我哋君子都會有比較謙卑嘅態度去待人處事啦，同埋比較有修養，亦都咧又係富有品德，就好似玉一樣咁堅韌啦、溫和同埋細膩嘅。 咁其實儒家思想啦，對我哋玉文化嘅影響咧係非常之深遠嘅，係促進咗一個玉器嘅蓬勃發展。So
in Chinese we have this saying, a gentleman of virtue is comparable to jade, and also a gentleman is never without jade. It means that if you carry a jade item, then you represent virtue and integrity. So you are like
jade. You have high integrity, and you have perseverance, you are mild, and you are delicate. And Confucianism also has deeply influenced jade culture in China and has contributed to the prosperous development of jade culture.
好啦，跟住下一個 slide。有冇人知我哋玉嘅五德係咩咧？在座，好，OK， 我開估就係咧玉咧，其實有五德嘅，分別咧就係有仁啦、義啦、智啦、勇同埋潔嘅。咁啊，咩意思咧？呢五德咁其實咧，我哋咧就會將手感嘅温潤啦，比喻成仁，將佢紋理內外嘅一致，比喻成義。 而玉清脆嘅聲音，我哋就視為智；佢質地嘅堅硬，我哋視為勇；佢棱角嘅尖鋭，我哋就視為潔。其實咧，呢五種咧都係玉器嘅特點嚟嘅。但係到咗後期啦，我哋睇玉器咧，其實就主要係睇佢個温潤啦。
So here we are talking about jade has five virtues, including benevolence, wisdom, courage, justice, and purity. So by benevolence, it means how you feel when you hold a jade item in your hand. And by wisdom, it means the texture, the outside pattern on jade item. And by courage, it means the xiang of the jade item. And by justice, it means how hard the jade is. Okay. And by purity, it means how sharp, okay, or how rough that jade is. But so in the past, we looked at all five features of jade. But nowadays, what we really look at is the first feature, benevolence. That is how we feel when we hold it in our hand.
玉器嘅時期啦，咁其實咧，玉器咧佢個文化底韻，啱啱提過係非常之深厚啦。咁我按照歷史時期發展咧，其實玉器咧喺唔同嘅時期咧都有住唔同嘅特徵同埋樣貌嘅喎。咁我哋咧今日咧都會將玉器簡單咁同大家介紹一下呢三個時期嘅。咁從佢嘅玉材啦、佢個雕工啦，同埋佢個審美角度啊、風俗習慣唔同咧，咁其實我哋玉嘅造型咧都會唔一樣噶。
So according to the raw material of jade and carving techniques, etc., we can divide jade items into three categories. So
好，咁我哋首先講一講高古玉啦。咁高古玉咧，其實咧就係處於一個文化期啦，夏商周啦，春秋戰國。 兩漢直到南北時期嘅一段時期啦，咁我哋都稱之佢為高古玉嘅。咁由於當時咧口狀之風盛行，以至大量嘅玉器咧都會應運而生，咁就做咗一種我哋叫做隨葬嘅玉器啦，就推動咗玉文化嘅發展喎。咁咧，可能有人問嚇，咁當時唔通冇讀書人嘅咩？文盲唔識字？ 唔係嘅，其實咧，我哋當時都會有叫做我哋文房嘅玉器嘅，但係因為咧口狀之風盛行咧，咁所以咧佢哋唔會有一個詞彙叫做文房，嗰陣時仲係未出現嘅，係啦，就唔係好盛行。咁咧呢度咧大家見到咧呢幅相咧，其實佢係一個印章嚟嘅。咁咧，但係當時咧呢個印章咧，我哋唔歸類佢為文房嘅器物嚟嘅喎。 因為咧，呢個印章係當時咧，其實係用於分辨一個先人嘅身份，係啦。
So the first category is archaic jade. So is jade items produced in Xiashangzhou dynasty, spring, autumn, and the Three Kingdoms dynasty and the Two Han dynasty. So elaborate funerals were very popular in those periods of time. So people would make these jade items for ceremony purposes. So on the screen, you can see this one is actually a seal, but it was not used by the educated class or intelligent people. Rather, this seal was used to identify the person who passed away.
跟住落嚟咧，就去到咧一個中古玉嘅時期啦。
咁中古玉咧，佢嘅時期咧就係秦唐宋元金時期係為主嘅。咁呢個時期咧，其實咧，我哋佛教嘅風氣啊，都開始盛行啦。所以你會見到咧，我哋玉器啦，有好多動物嘅紋飾啊，一啲胡人啊、飛天啊、獅子紋啊、仙佛嘅題材都會比較多啲嘅。咁玉器咧就更加注重咧佢嘅裝飾啊，同埋要提現出一個生活嘅氣息啦。咁文房嘅用品咧喺呢段時期咧，其實都慢慢多起上嚟噶。咁呢個時期嘅玉器嘅特點咧，佢除咗有一個實用價值之外啦，佢加之咧都仲有一個欣賞嘅價值嘅。
So the second category is ancient jade. So these were mainly items produced in the Sui, Tang, Song, Jing, and Yuan dynasties. And also Buddhism started to become popular in these periods of time. So you can see in these jade items, they were mostly with animal patterns, plants, motifs, spiritual figures, line patterns, and also with more colors. And then also in this period of time, jade items for scholarly use or useful in study also started to become more and more, and they also became more practical.
大家可以睇一睇啦，呢度我擺咗一個咧係荷花形嘅筆洗啦。咁其實荷花都係當時我哋佛教傳統嘅一個好重要嘅特質嚟嘅。
So on top of the screen here, the first picture you can see is a lotus flower shape. It's a tray for washing, whitening brushes. And as I think you probably know, lotus flower is also one important element in Buddhist culture.
咁跟住咧，就我哋重中之重啦，就係明清玉啦。 咁去到明清時期啦，由於統治者嘅倡導啦，所以佢玉雕嘅技藝咧係去到非常之精湛。咁佢玉器嘅種類咧，亦都非常之豐富啦。大大其實已經超越咗前代噶啦。咁就喺我哋玉文化上邊咧，提升到一個前所未有嘅高度啦。咁佢嘅雕琢嘅形製啊，都會更加精美嘅。 咁咧，明清時期嘅玉器啦，大家都見到佢其實係千姿百態啊，造型都各異嘅。因為咧，當時啊，清代嘅玉匠佢係好喜歡用借鑑一啲繪畫啊、雕刻啊，同埋一啲工藝嘅元素去放入去佢哋嘅創作方面。咁咧，同埋佢哋用嘅工藝咧，都會有陰刻啊、陽刻啊、柳空啊呢啲咁嘅傳統技藝嘅。 所以佢同埋佢哋都吸收咗咧一啲外來嘅文化，去影響咗佢哋啦，去融會變通啦。所以佢哋個玉器睇起上嚟咧，嗰個工藝性啊、創造性啊同埋裝飾性咧都係非常之高噶。So
the third category is jade items produced in Ming and Qing dynasties. So because the emperors also supported jade culture, the carving techniques in this period of time were very sophisticated and even went beyond those techniques in the past. And jade culture also reached its peak during this time period. And the carvings were very delicate and exquisite, also were in many different shapes. And also carvers would incorporate different other techniques, including painting, art, calligraphy, etc., into their works. And also relief and hollow out carving techniques also would be used in their work. As they also had absorbed foreign cultures, their works also became more creative.
之後咧，又同大家介紹一下玉石之路咯。玉石之路咧，顧名思義咧，就係運我哋玉石嘅一條道路啦。咁咧，因為我啱啱都提過啦，當時咧嗰個統治者咁佢就好中意玉雕呢個技藝啦。咁尤其是乾隆皇帝啦，佢係非常之中意玉嘅，所以咧佢就下令咧佢哋嘅嗰個叫仆人啦，係啦，要到新疆嘅和田，因為新疆嘅和田咧係最靚嘅玉嚟噶，就要從新疆嘅和田咧。
將我哋嘅玉運到去京城，大家可以睇一睇咧。其實個路線係非常之遠嘅。咁佢當時咧，亦都冇任何嘅交通工具啦，唔似得我哋而家搭車又搭船啦，跟住又有角度啦。其實佢哋咧當時係要好多個人扶住一部馬車，人力物力去將呢啲玉石咧一嚿一嚿咁樣運到去京城嘅。同埋咧，玉石咧唔好睇我哋而家好似細細件喎。 當時其實玉石咧係個原料嚟嘅，所以佢其實好大件嘅。我哋係要動用到好多個人，其實先可以推到一件嘅。咁咧我都查過啲資料，其實咧和田咧去北京咧有成3000900幾公里嘅，係啊。咁如果咧我哋咧北面北休咧日日咁行咧，其實都要行1個月，所以你諗下佢哋當時仲要係道路咁唔發達嘅時候啊，其實佢哋運一嚿玉嘅原料可能要花成年嘅時間先可以運到啊。所以點解我哋話玉咁珍貴咧？珍貴在唔單止佢工藝同埋佢背後其實係有血有汗嘅。
So now I'm going to talk about the jade roll, which means how jade was transported in the past. As I said, the emperor, especially Emperor Qianlong, loved jade very much. So he ordered people to especially go to Hetian in Xinjiang to transport jade to the capital. It was really a long route, as you could see on the map here. And as they didn't have cars, so the jade could only be carried by horse carriages and escorted by a lot of people because the jade could be so big. It was only raw material. So it took a lot of people to transport one jade to the capital from Xinjiang. And I have done some research. The route can be 3,900 kilometers in length. So even nowadays, if we walk, it would take us a month. And think about it, in the past, the road condition was not good. I think maybe it could take them a year to transport a jade from Xinjiang to the capital then. So we say jade is very precious, not only about its techniques, but also about how it was transported in the past.
跟住之後咧，同大家講一講呢個製玉圖咯。咁呢個製玉圖咧，而家咧係存喺呢個故宮博物院嘅。咁啊，清光緒年間啦，一個叫做李晴淵嘅文人雅士所繪嘅。咁咧，佢就記錄到啦當時我哋做玉嘅工藝。咁由於今日時間關係，我就唔一一同大家展開啦。咁一陣間大家有興趣咧，我都可以將呢個資料 send 俾你哋嘅。咁而家我就俾一條短片，大家大概有一個概念。
So now I'm going to talk about the procedure of jade's making. Actually, this book is showcased in the Palace Museum in Beijing, and it shows the steps of the making of jade, but I'm not going to talk about them in detail. Instead, I will show you a short video now. And if you are interested, I can send you this book later.
清朝光绪年间绘制的古代制玉工艺流程。古代玉工在制玉前，首先要先研磨出解玉砂。解玉砂是从江河的泥沙中，通过除捣、过滤筛选出来的石英砂和金刚砂。有了解玉砂之后，玉工需要两人配合。 用钢丝像拉锯一样切割玉料，解玉砂和水放置在茶壶中，滴在钢丝上增加锋利度，才能达到切割玉器的目的。
非常慢，一天恐怕也拉不了一寸的口子。
为了加工玉器更细致的工艺，中国古人发明了水镫，通过绞灯的方式，靠麻绳旋转木轴。
用锋利的金属配合解玉砂，完成造型、镂空、花纹等制玉工艺。好，咁呢个就系一个制玉图咯。我今日都唔会展开住嘅。好啦。 咁就嚟翻我哋文房玉器啦。咁其實咧，明清時。 時期嘅玉器咧，佢因為受到一個文化生活啊關係都好密切啦。咁文人咧喺佢哋作畫啊、書寫啊嘅時候咧，都往往咧都會用一啲玉器嚟做佢哋嘅案頭之物嘅喎。例如我哋有筆洗啊、水柱啊、筆筒、墨床，甚至同埋被角等等嘅。咁咧，我哋都有句説話啦，叫做文房自古多藏玉。其實就係講啊，文人咧佢其實都好注重佢哋自己生活嘅品味噶。所以咧，一個佢哋覺得書房入邊咧，玉器咧都係一個唔可以缺少嘅案頭之物。
So now here we come to Jade scholars' objects. So as we know, in the past, Chinese scholars really liked having jade items in their study on their desk. For example, a tray for washing brushes and brushes holders and also paperweight, because these jade items also showed reflect their taste. So they really liked having these items in their study.
咁今日咧就為大家介紹啦，我哋其中一件藏品就係叫做二甲全露白玉旁蟹鎮子。咁咧鎮子咧，顧名思義咧，就係寫字我哋用嚟壓住紙張嘅物件嚟嘅。咁喺書房入邊啦，鎮子其實歷史咧都非常之悠久噶啦。我哋可以追溯翻到魏晉南北朝啊。咁啊，因為佢哋咧造型都各異啦，同埋工藝精湛，我哋堪稱為文房嘅第五寶。 好勁啊！紙筆墨砚咧，第四寶佢就第五啦。咁咧鎮子咧，其實作為文人雅士嘅案頭之物啦，佢唔淨止係一件叫做文具，佢亦都係一件好賞心悅目嘅藝術品啦。咁咧鎮子咧，通常我哋擺喺台上面擲住張紙咧，咁張紙就唔會咁容易喐啊，所以我哋寫字嗰陣時就可以好好咁樣一氣呵成。
So the first item I'm going to share with you is this paperweight. So paperweight is something we put on paper to hold them still. So it is also considered the fifth precious item for scholar. So a paperweight is not only a stationery, but it can also be used for appreciation. It's because when you have a paperweight to hold your paper still, then you can do everything calmly.
咁咧，大家可以睇一睇張圖啊。其實我哋咧以前嘅鎮子咧就係咁樣用噶，紅色圈圈圈住嗰個就係鎮子嚟嘅。So
the thing in the red circle is a paperweight in the past.
好啦，咁跟住都同大家講一講啦，蟹。 咁大閘蟹就舐舐你啦，好好味啦。咁但係咧，對於古人嚟講咧，蟹咧佢唔單止係一種食物喎，其實佢都有特殊嘅寓意嘅。咁明清時期啦，我哋嗰個都有一個叫做科舉考試啦，都分三級嘅。咁我哋稱之為三甲。咁咧一甲一名咧，我哋就叫做狀元榜眼同埋探花啦。咁一甲一名咧，我哋咧就稱之為狀元嘅。咁蟹，因為佢本身咧佢有一個好硬嘅殼啊，所以咧我哋譬如為好似一個武士嘅盔甲咁樣。咁咧就視為係一甲嘅象徵啦，喺當時。咁咧大家仔細睇啦，我哋呢個蟹嘅蟹鉗上邊咧，其實佢係有鉗住一個蘆葦嘅。咁蘆葦咧係咩意思咧？就係寓意係二甲全蘆。咁咧當時咧，全蘆咧其實即 所以大家可以試一試佢嘅真藝啊。
So you may wonder why this paperweight was carved in a crab shape. Maybe in your mind, crab is just
a food, but actually in Chinese culture, crab also symbolizes academic success. As we know, in the Ming and Qing dynasties, there was the Chinese imperial exam, so people would really like to get a good position in the exam. So crab, as it has a very hard shell, it represents the amour of a warrior. And as you can see also in this jade item, there is a reed in the crab's claws. Actually, it represents that you can get a good position in the Chinese imperial exam. That's why in the past, people would like to put on a crab item on their body so that it's like a good symbol. So if you guys want to get a good position in any exam, just wear a crab item.
好啦，咁咧其實蟹咧，佢喺古時咧，仲有另外一個寓意嘅喎，就叫做前甲子啦，就代表住富甲天下嘅意思。八方來財啊，都中橫四海嘅。咁所以咧，自古以嚟啦，我哋都會好中意蟹啦，同埋其實蟹咧仲有一個寓意嘅喎，就和諧，因為佢係嗰個諧音相關啊。 咁跟住落嚟咧，我都會有一條短片去介紹俾大家，我哋可以睇一睇我哋呢個蟹嘅工藝嘅。
So crab in the past also represented wealth. That's why people really liked crabs, and because 蟹, the xiang is like mohai in Chinese, which means harmony. So people really liked it. Now I'm going to show you a short video.
Hi，开头系无声嘅。是白玉蟹，以和田白玉雕镀而成，玉质通透，湿若银丝，背甲流皮，包浆浑厚。玉螃蟹之雕镀技艺不简单，其仿生圆雕手法雕镀而成，复以浮雕、透雕、镂空雕，整体圆润如意，身体两侧各处四肢。 小足翘下一尺相连，背部背甲雕镀细腻，箭矢的两只斜钳自前自于头部，并雕镀出关节，可谓活灵活现。贝壳上面雕有刻缝，前面有四个凸起，两眼上挑，神态传神，让人爱不释手。两只斜钳前着一根芦苇。 寓意二甲全奴，其源于中国古代的科举制度，三甲分别为状元、榜眼、探发，寄托着古代读书人对仕途的美好祈愿。
跟住咧，因為明清時期啦，文人士大夫啦，藏玉之風都非常之盛行啦，所以咧具有呢個吉兆之意嘅螃蟹咧，自然都會成為玉雕工匠嘅雕琢對象嘅。所以咧，好多時咧都會將佢雕琢成一啲嘅配飾啊，又或者文房嘅一啲用品啊。咁咧，其實佢唔單止係我哋古代文人一個心態嘅寫照啦，佢其實咧都係一個傳承承載之物啦，都寄予咧我哋。
So the symbols of crabs explain why people in the past liked collecting crab items. So there were also a lot of jade crab works, whether for used as accessories or as items used in study.
咁大家可以睇一睇啦，而家圖上邊嘅呢個就係故宮博物院藏嘅一個白玉雙蟹。This
is another jade crab item, and it's now in Palace Museum in Beijing.
係啦，跟住落嚟咧，我哋就介紹我哋另一件嘅藏品啦，就係青玉獸圖形嘅筆洗。咁咧，筆洗咧。 它其實就在文房裏面是用來裝水洗筆的器皿來的，因為我們傳統的毛筆很容易沾到墨汁，它容易折斷，所以我們時不時畫畫畫都要洗一洗筆再畫的。玉質的筆洗最早出現可以追溯到秦漢的時期。 漢代之後，其實玉質的文具都開始越來越多。目前以我們所知，最早的玉筆洗就收藏在故宮博物院的一件漢代的螫龍紋的玉洗。漢代以後，隨著玉器的推廣和普及，以及古代文房用品的玉質筆洗的出現都越來越多。 歷代的文人士大夫都會認為自己書房裏面有一件玉筆洗是為榮的，尤其是一些貴族，他們都會很喜歡在他們的文房裏面放一件玉筆洗，覺得這樣才是一個典型的文房應該要有的東西。因為玉筆洗 在我們中國的傳統裏面的技術已經是非常之純熟，加上我們當時的工匠們其實他們的技術都已經是非常之高的，又匯合了一些古代文人的審美的概念，所以玉筆洗除了實用之外，它的觀賞價值也都非常之高。
So another item that I'm going to talk about is this one, a Celadon jade peach from brush washer. So by brush washer, it is actually like a tray for washing brushes. So the use of jade brush washer can date back to Qing Dynasty, but after the Han Dynasty, people started to use more and more jade items as stationaries. And in the Beijing's Palace Museum, you can also see some jade stationaries used in Han Dynasty. In the past, Chinese people, the Chinese educated class, were really proud of having jade brush washer in their study. And also the higher classes would also consider it necessary to have a jade brush washer in their house. And also as the techniques were getting more sophisticated, so people were not only using jade brush washer for practical purposes, but also would appreciate them for their aesthetic values.
其實我本身想問你們覺得它像什麼形的，但我忘記了，其實我已經說了它是陶形的筆洗。我們為什麼會用陶來做一個概念？其實陶在我們古代來說都是一個很有寓意的 題材來的，是啦，陶其實是一個我們叫做祝壽之物，我們都會稱它為壽土，寓意就是長命百歲。大家應該可能都有聽過西王母盤桃宴，王母娘娘她就掌管這個盤桃樹，樹呢 就會結果啦，據說食咗就會長生不老嘅。每逢呢個盤桃盛宴啦，王母娘娘都會著到好靚啦，然之後帶住鳳冠就飛落去，就會有好多神仙啦，同埋仙女下面都會拎住個壽土嚟同王母娘娘一齊去慶祝咁樣嘅。據說呢，王母娘娘種咗3600棵呢個盤桃樹，3000年結果啦，如果我哋 食3000年嘅話咧，得道成仙；我哋食6000年嘅話咧，長生不老；食9000年勁，真係勁，直情可以以天地齊壽。咁咧，所以咧，我哋點解咧？我哋成日都會用壽桃嚟做一個題材咧，就因為咧，代表住咧係長命百歲啊！咁啊，王母娘娘咧，每逢呢個節日咧，都會帶齊啲果咧，同呢個眾卿家、眾仙家嚟享樂嘅。
So you may wonder why the brush washer was carved into a peach form. It's because in Chinese culture, peach is a symbol of longevity. This picture is the peach festival. I'm not sure if you have heard about it, but in the middle, you can see this Chinese goddess, Wang Mo Leng Leng. So during the feast
during this feast, she would have all other goddesses or other these figures in the myths would bring her a lot of peaches, so wishing her immortality and longevity. So in Chinese culture, if you we would say that if you eat a peach, then you will become immortal and have longevity.
好啦，咁大家咧仔細睇一睇，大家有冇人數到我哋呢個世上面有幾多個圖啊？
Do you can you count how many patterns there are on this J brush washer?
係啦，咁咧其實咧，我哋嗰個水洗嘅左面同埋右邊兩邊咧都各一個，咁咧跟住咧上面咧，上面其實都有一個嘅，寫咗個壽字嘅，咁咧其實係啦，其實佢有三個圖嘅紋飾喺上面嘅，咁咧三個圖咧，我哋又寓意咧為三壽啊，咁即係都係長壽嘅意思，即係話哦，你有三個壽咁長啊。 所以在文房裡面我們都會譽為這個複雜延綿是文人士大夫對我們健康生活的一個嚮往來的。So
on the left side and on the right side, there is one pattern each. And on top, you can see another pattern is the character of longevity in Chinese. So by having this item, you are having three longevities. So people really liked having this in their study because it showed how they longed for good health and longevity.
跟住咧，我哋都睇下佢底座喎。雖然佢就唔係玉嚟嘅，但係佢都好有意思嘅。咁咧，上邊咧其實咧佢有三隻羊。咁三羊咧係我哋古代意思啦，就係三羊開泰啦。咁三羊開泰咧其實咧係嚟自我哋中國嘅一個哲學嘅書籍啦，咁就叫做《周易》。 咁咧《周易》咧入邊咧佢64卦入邊咧就講正月，我哋叫做太卦，三陽生於夏。 冬去春來，陰消陽長，有吉祥亨通之象。咁嘅意思就係話咧，我哋農曆正月咧冬去春來啦，係一個好時節啊。所以我哋咧成日都話三陽啟泰嘅意思就係話新嘅一年，我哋希望咧事事都蒸蒸日上，國泰民安咁嘅意思。 咁其實三陽咧，本三陽開泰咧，本身同陽佢係冇一個好直接嘅關係嘅。但係我哋以前啦，就有一個叫做通假字。咁其實我哋陽係同長係一個通假字嚟嘅。咁咧，所以咧就會有吉祥嘅意思。而我哋咧以前咧，你都會見到有一啲器物上邊咧，可能佢都會刻有吉祥，唔係吉陽呢個字眼。咁其實咧都係吉祥咁嘅意思咯。 係啦，咁而我哋咧陽字啦，咁其實都同太陽嘅陽，因為係同音嘅關係啦，所以咧我哋都會咧比喻咧三陽開泰呢個題材嚟表達呢個太平盛世嘅。
So this is the base of the brush washer. It is not made of jade, but of wood. It is still meaningful because you can see three golds. In this base. In Chinese culture, gold is always an auspicious symbol because in one of our classic philosophical books, it is said that in the first month of Chinese calendar, it can always bring us good luck. And also gold in Chinese shares similar sign as good luck and shares similar sign as sun, the character of sun. So gold is always a symbol of good luck, auspicious things. So this space is also very meaningful.
咁跟住落嚟啦，我都有條短片俾大家睇一睇呢個水洗嘅工藝嘅。
I'm now also going to show you another video. It's very thin.
玉石以和田青玉雕琢而成，以这么大块玉料深化雕琢成寿桃形，这是很难得的。其采用了多种高深的玉雕工艺，包括圆雕、蚕底、浮雕、镂空雕、薄胎、阳刻、 抛光等，每一项无不费工费时，对技艺的要求极高。细看这洗内壁啊，纤薄细滑，外壁雕有寿桃及梅花，周围攀满了桃树的枝叶，这都是严刻的工艺，简底严刻，突出它的梅花的厚度还有立体感，把手透雕树藤而成，可以看见树藤高低错落，下面还刻有一个寿字的寿桃，还有花朵，彼此啊展花寿图，很难得的，再加上三阳开泰的双枝底座，更寓意着吉祥福寿。文房之中，富泽延绵，体现了文人对于健康生活的向往。整器形状，纹寿端庄，雕工精美绝伦，为案头增添了人文日趣的佳品。
咁跟住咧，我哋睇一睇呢個咧，佢就係喺北京藝術博物館藏嘅一件半陶形嘅筆洗，其實同我哋嗰件咧係非常之相似啊。
This is another jade piece from brush washer now in Beijing Art Museum, and it is very similar to the one that we just saw in the video.
好啦，跟住嚟緊咧，我就會為大家介紹一件青白玉黑梅花嘅蓋盒。咁佢有個底款嘅就係乾隆年制，係四字款。咁咧，印盒啦，顧名思義咧，就係放印泥嘅一個盒嚟嘅。咁咧，據呢個史書記載咧，其實我哋印泥嘅發展已經有2000多年歷史噶啦。咁早喺春秋啊、秦漢嘅時期咧，就已經有印心泥啦。咁印泥嘅前身其實佢係泥封嚟嘅，係用於宮廷入邊啦。佢係即係蓋嗰啲書信上邊咧都會有個章，咁唔係咁容易俾人哋可以透睇到入邊啲機密嘅，就好似我哋而家有時有啲帖咧都會有嗰啲膠嘅章臘章，係啦係啦，就係咁嘅意思咯。咁咧我哋可以睇一睇，咁其實全世嘅印泥入邊啦，唐代咧已經係有噶啦呢啲印盒，咁咧所以我哋可以推斷到啦，印盒咧佢係唔晚於唐朝就已經出現噶啦，咁佢係宋朝咧盛係。工藝是最靚的，跟住咧，亦都係印泥嘅主要作用，泥盒啦，佢主要作用咧，其實都係為咗防止我哋嗰、那個入邊嘅油墨去乾啊，所以我哋一定要吸住佢。咁咧其實我哋印盒咧，咁佢個工藝咧都係受到我哋胭脂盒嘅影響嘅，因為其實咧古時嘅印盒咧係同胭脂盒咧係非常之相似嘅。咁咧最咁。其實咧，佢都影響咗好多咧，我哋呢個印盒嘅一啲造型上面嘅發展啦。咁咧，宋朝後期之後咧，印泥盒咧都逐漸咧普及啊，開始成為咧文人士大夫嘅一個案頭之物啦。慢慢咧，印盒上邊嘅主題咧亦都越嚟越多啊。我哋唔一定係會花紋啊，其實有時咧花鳥紋啊，各種題材咧都會有噶。
So this one is a jade box and cover used to carry a sealed paste. So it's a sealed paste box. And on the back of the box, you can see it's made in Qianlong era. So it's used to put sealed paste. And the use of sealed paste actually has a history of more than 2,000 years and could date back to the Spring and Autumn Dynasty and the Qing Dynasty.So in the past, government officials would use this seal paste to seal letters, just like the wax seals that we use nowadays.
And for seal paste box, I think it's started to be used in Tang Dynasty, but in Song Dynasty, the use of seal paste box reached its peak. And using this kind of box can prevent the ink from drying out. And also the design of this kind of box was influenced by the design of boxes for carrying rook, cheek paint cosmetics. So it's very beautiful.
明代、屠龍在他的一本文房器具簪裏都特意為印泥盒開了一個新篇章。其實印泥盒不一定是圓形的，它多數是圓形，其實它也有其他的形製。它和它不同的材質都會見到，好像玉石、竹木、鑑鑑、漆器，其實都會有的。 但是印泥盒其實最多的它會是瓷質，玉製的印泥盒我們就會比較少見一些。
There was also even a book chapter in Chinese classic dedicated to seal paste box. And actually, seal paste box is not only made in round shape, they are also in different shapes. And they are not only made from jade, but also from other materials and other stones. And actually, it is not very common to use jade, to carve jade into a seal paste box. Seal paste boxes are more commonly found to be made in porcelain.
咁呢张图啦，可以话到俾大家听啦。其实我哋当时嗰个印泥盒咧，就会咁样使用嘅。
So this picture shows you how people in the past used seal paste box.
好啦，咁跟住咧，我哋就講翻我哋印泥盒上面個畫面咯。咁點解會取材自梅花呢？咁其實咧，梅花咧喺我國嘅歷史咧都非常悠久啦，被譽為咧係全春報喜一個吉祥之意嘅。咁咧，其實原來咧梅花咧都有四德嘅。 咁佢啱啱咧係蕊嘅時候咧，我哋叫佢為圓啦；開花嘅時候，我哋叫佢亨啦；結籽嘅時候咧，我哋就叫佢做利啦；而成熟嘅時候咧，我哋就叫佢做精嘅。咁咧，我哋都會認為咧，梅花咧其實佢五塊花瓣咧都有寓意嘅喎，係象徵住五福，咁即係快樂啦、幸福啊、長壽、順利同埋和平嘅。
So on the seal paste box, you can see the pattern of plum blossoms. In Chinese culture, plum represents spring and also happiness. And plum also is a symbol of four virtues. They represent the four different stages of plum blossoms. And also the petals of plum also are symbols of five happiness in Chinese culture.
高洁孤傲，觉得佢系有坚韧不拔嘅性格嘅，亦都系我哋中华民族嘅其中一种精神嚟嘅，代表住我哋系坚韧不拔啦，然之后奋勇当先啦，自强不息嘅呢个精神。咁咧，作为咧韩遂三友之一咧，其实自古以嚟咧，我哋对佢都赞赏有加嘅。历代咧，其实我哋都有好多梅花题材嘅好好嘅藏品咧，系流传于世嘅。
So plum also is a symbol of perseverance, which is also a spirit of Chinese people. So it represents that Chinese people are persistent and will not give up easily. And actually, plum blossoms is also used in a lot of artworks.
系啦，咁大家可以睇一睇啦。呢一个作品咧就系北宋诗人咧林甫佢嘅《山园小梅》。 咁咧，佢入邊咧就有一句説話叫做疏影橫斜水清淺，暗香浮動月黃昏。咁嘅意思就係咧，喺月色之下，一個梅枝咧就映入去水中，然之後淡淡嘅梅香咧就飄埋嚟。我哋咧就好似喺一個文人意境入邊咧，被一啲梅花嘅香氣圍繞住我哋啊，彷彿好似不食人間煙火咁樣。咁當時咧，乾隆皇帝咧下江南嘅時候咧，佢咧就去咗我哋蘇州府丘一個叫定遠嘅地方。咁咧就俾佢個定遠入邊嘅梅花感染咗，所以佢積極咧就揮毫。 就找了一塊石在那塊石裡面就提了這首詩下去，那乾隆皇帝其實就很喜歡，他一喜歡的東西他就御題詩了，所以我們有時很多古代的藏品你都會見到有乾隆的御題詩在上面的，現在那塊石頭都還在這個定園裡面，就成為了一個很出名的景點啦。 所以如果大家有空的時候，不妨都走去這個苦丘的定園那裡感受一下文人氣息，摸一摸乾隆的字，是的。
This work actually is by a Chinese poet called Leng. Actually it represents it creates a scenery where you can see the reflection on a lake, and then you can smell the fragrance of plum blossoms. So it's a very beautiful scene created here. And also in the past, when Qianlong Emperor visited southern China, when he went to arrive at a park with a lot of plum blossoms, he was so happy. So he wrote a poem, and the poem was inscribed on a big stone in that park he visited, and that stone can still be seen nowadays.
接下來我也有個短片給大家看一看這個印盒的工藝。
Now I'm going to show you a video about this silk paste box.
In离合一般多为池子，采用和田白玉雕做而成的比较少见。其核形制扁圆，核与盖为子母口，紧闭咬合，工艺精湛，称为圆整的一体。玉质温润晶莹，包浆莹润。对于古代的玉工来说，雕做两个绝对相同的圆，无疑是一种考验。细细去用手感说。 其莹润的内壁布满手工的痕迹，仿佛穿越时空与那古人相见。盒盖上雕有栩栩如生的梅花。盒子它是采用整挖工艺，是一整块玉，把它深挖成一个坑，然后再以打磨抛光的手法雕琢而成。 它刀工细腻，上面的梅花以刻的手段，细细的把梅花的形状雕琢出来。这时候，不能使用太过用力的手法去雕琢，不然的话，它这么薄的玉很容易就会因此破碎。雕琢精妙，可用合上。 合顶落乾隆年纪算舒缓，字体工整严谨，是件难得的清代玉器珍品。 A little bit long, I think.
感动。 接下來我們可以看一看，這個是台北國立故宮博物院的館藏，一件青玉雕梅花小圓盒，這個也是一個印盒來的。This
is another silk paste box now kept in National Palace Museum in Taiwan.
最後一件為大家介紹的就是白玉紫光款的姜太公釣魚陶佩。 都recall翻啦，啱啱一開始啦，同大家都有提過啦，君子無故玉不去身，就文人雅士都好鍾意戴住玉嘅喎。咁其實佢哋都好鍾意咧戴住個玉佩。咁玉佩咧，佢係一件我哋叫做可以係一件裝飾品啦，喺古時咧都會掛喺衣服呢個衣帶上面嘅。咁佢唔僅僅有裝飾嘅作用啦，其實佢都係一個宗教精神嘅一個傳達嚟嘅。
咁喺文化時期咧，其實就已經有呢種培育嘅習慣噶啦。咁咧，直至到咧依家咧都係有嘅。咁玉器咧個玉佩咧，依然到依家嘅話咧，中國人都係好崇尚呢個風俗啦。覺得佢係一個好高端嘅飾品啦，同埋佢有一個傳承嘅作用。就好似我而家有一個玉佩，我戴完之後可能會將佢傳承俾我自己嘅兒女，咁樣一代接一代落去嘅，係啦。咁咧，紫光牌咧又係點解叫紫光牌咧？其實紫光牌咧係相傳係一個明代咧個玉雕大師叫做陸紫光去開創嘅。咁啊，陸紫光咧就係明嘉慶同埋萬歷年間嘅雕玉高手。咁佢所雕嘅玉器咧都非常之出名啦，而皇帝咧都係即係叫佢做一個御用嘅玉雕嘅師傅咁樣嘅。咁咧，紫光牌咧，佢一個特點嘅，就係咧，我哋通常咧一面都會係有一啲人物啊、山水嘅畫面，而另外一面咧就會係有一首詩嘅。咁同埋咧，紫光牌其實佢對於玉嘅工藝啊、玉材係非常之講究，佢一定係要用最上乘嘅和田嘅玉料啦，同埋一定要揀到嗰個料係冇一啲土沉啊、冇一啲裂紋，佢先可以用嚟做紫光牌嘅。咁都深當時都深受一啲文人士大夫嘅歡迎。
So this piece is a white jade plate. Depicting this picture where a Chinese figure Jiang Taigong was fishing. So this plate was used as an ornament or an accessory in the past. People would carry it on their waist, and actually this custom is still practiced nowadays. On the previous slide, you can see the word Zigang, Zigang plague. So Zigang actually is the name of a carving master in the Ming Dynasty. He was very famous and had very sophisticated carving techniques that the emperor would even ask him to specifically carve jade items for him. So this one, Zigang plague, usually on a Zigang plague, you can see on the one side, there is like a picture depicting a figure doing something or with some mountains or sceneries. And then on the other side, you can see usually a poem. So there are high requirements for making Zigang play because usually we need to use He Tian jade to carve Zigang play. So the condition of the jade needs to be almost perfect. That's why it was very popular among scholars in the past.
同埋都補充翻咧，其實紫光牌咧，佢多數咧都會係長方形製嘅，係啦。咁咧，你大家咧會見到呢個畫面啦，見到有個魚翁啦，佢釣住條大魚咁樣。咁其實咧，這個都係我哋古代嘅一個神話故事咁樣啦，就叫做姜太公釣魚。
So Zigang plate is usually in rectangular shape, and this man is fishing. You can see in that picture on the one side of this Zigang plate, and it's from one of the folklores in Chinese culture.
咁咧，姜太公啦，姜子牙啦，即係咁，其實咧佢就係商末周初個軍事家嚟嘅。咁嗰陣時咧，商就暴虐啦。咁阿周文王咧，其實就想推翻呢個暴政。咁姜太公其實都好想幫佢手嘅，但係咧佢喺度諗，唉，我年紀又咁老啦，同阿周文王又冇乜兩句咁樣，都唔知佢會唔會用我啲方法㗎。於是咧，佢又諗咗條橋。就走咗去條河嗰度咧，就釣魚。咁我哋一般咧釣魚咧都會用個彎嘅勾住魚脷，你先會釣魚噶嘛。但係佢唔係喎，佢用一個直勾，仲要係唔放魚脷嚟釣魚。咁咧有一日咧，阿周文王咧經過嗰陣時候就覺得哇，點解呢個老嘢咁奇怪嘅？佢竟然用直勾釣魚嘅，於是咧就走過同佢傾偈啦。一傾之下，先發現，原來佢奇才嚟嘅喎，就覺得所以就邀請咗姜太公咧去幫佢咧去探討一啲議政啊咁樣咯。於是咧，咁姜太公咧亦都好順利幫佢一齊去建立咗呢個周朝。 所以之後我們就有姜太公釣魚這個典故，就代表著我們所有東西都順其自然，不要強求，不要奢求太多，都不要誇眾取寵，憑自己的實力你就會慢慢得到人家的尊重和垂青的了。
So let me talk about the story behind this picture. This figure is Jiang Taigong. So he's a figure, and he's a military expert. He's a figure in the early Zhou Dynasty. So at that time, so it was the beginning of the Zhou Dynasty, and he was not sure if the emperor wanted his help or not to develop the country. And so one day he went to a river to fish, but without any bait. So Zhou Emperor saw him and thought it was very strange. So the Emperor went to talk to him, and he found out that Jiang Taigong, this figure, was a real wise man. That's why he invited Jiang Taigong to help him to develop the country. So the meaning of this story actually tells us that we don't need to pay too much effort to ask for anything with our real competence, and actually we can show ourselves and can be used.
咁跟住咧，啱啱紫光牌咧，其實佢另一面咧就係有一首詩嘅其中一句。咁呢首詩咧，其實就係出自杜甫嘅《秋興八首之七》。咁佢嗰句説話咧就係、是。關塞極天懷鳥道，江湖滿地一魚翁。咁咧點解會有呢首詩呢？咁其實咧嗰陣時咧，杜甫啦，佢仕途就有啲坎坷啦，就好唔開心。跟住咧，佢有一日咧就走咗去一個郊區嗰度，去自己病埋一邊啦，感懷下身世咁樣啦。跟住咧，點樣知佢離遠咧就見到有個漁翁喺度釣魚喎。咁個漁翁釣魚咧仲好開心喎，佢就喺度諗啊，點解佢咁開心嘅咧？跟住咧後屘佢就體化咗，就覺得哎係啊，點解我成日都要被一啲唔開心嘅事去纏繞自己啊？點解我唔可以開心啲啊？所以咧，作者咧其實咧就做呢個牌嗰陣時，就係寄予我哋，無論遇到咩困難都好，我哋都放開心情，唔好執著喺一邊，唔好鑽牛角尖，事情慢慢都會好噶。
So as I said, usually on one side of the Zigang play, you could see a poem, and this poem the poem on the special piece that I showed you was a poem by Du Fu. So this poem actually depicts a scene. Where Du Fu, as he was not doing well in his career, so one day he went to a lake, and then he saw a man fishing very happily. So suddenly he realized that he really shouldn't be bothered by those trivial things in life. Instead, he should be happy. So this poem actually sends us a message that we just let go of those sad things and stay happy.
好，跟住落嚟咧，就我哋最後有一個 video 啦，都 share 俾大家睇一睇呢個紫光牌嘅工藝。
Also, one more video showing this piece.
尺间白玉诗文玉佩，形制小巧，以白玉雕镀而成，玉质温润剔透，包针自然醇厚。胚身上呈长方形，上面钻一小孔，以四成。牌首啊是有双螭龙纹，并自然围绕成为长方形的开光。紫钢牌的技艺精湛且繁复，在一小小的玉牌中。运用各种精妙的手法，其先在方形开光外凸起那个弦边框，边框里以刀工剪地一层，就是用刀慢慢去把它烧薄，这种技艺叫做剪底。在平整的地址上覆起压地引起什么浅浮雕的手法，形成着高低错落之感，细作出这一幅姜太公钓鱼图。
老解，书法洁白，神态自然，周围水草丰茂，身后竹子挺白，人物刻画四字入微，惟巧惟妙。背面刻有杜甫的诗文《抽薪白首》，观菜即天为了道，张无满地一语录，落款子刚，字体挺白，在方寸之间，尽请玉工之精，玉指之美。子刚牌以精美的玉料，高超的技艺手法，将印章、书法、绘画的艺术融入到艺术当中，使书画变成可随身携带之物，成为千百年来历久不衰的经典之作。
好啦，咁其實乾隆時期咧都係一個用玉嘅高峰期嚟嘅喎，因為咧乾隆皇帝咧佢非常之好玉啦，所以佢就開辦咗呢個造辦處啦，去做一啲玉作，係呢啲玉器咧全部都係供皇室之用嘅。咁咧嗰啲玉匠咧好多都係嚟自蘇州啊、揚州啊呢啲地區為主嘅，所以當時咧我哋就話蘇作啊同埋揚州嗰邊嘅工藝咧嘅玉雕工藝都係非常之文明嘅。
嗯。So in the Qianlong Emperor era, jade was used very widely, so the government even set up an office to organize workshops to make jade items, and the carvers were mainly from Suzhou and Yangzhou. So the carvers from these places were very well known for their skills and techniques.
咁跟住咧，我哋可以睇一睇啦。呢一件係而家故宮博物院藏嘅黃玉紫光款竹林七賢培。咁佢都係咧一面係做咗呢、這個繪畫，然之後另一面咧就係、是、一個詩咁樣嘅。
So this is another Zigang plaque or pendant. Now it's kept in Palace Museum in Beijing. So you can also see picture on one side and a poem on the other side.
咁啦，到最尾啦，我哋都 recall 翻啦。其實我哋文房咧玩嘅係一種精神，書房咧係我哋一個精神嘅樂園啦。對比而家，其實我哋都有好多人啦，澳門可能少啲啦，但係中國內地啦，佢哋都會好中意咧，將自己嘅書房咧做翻咧好似以前宋代清朝嗰陣時咧嗰種風格嘅，而去體會翻當時嘅一種文人氣息。
So lastly, just want to say that when we talk about a study or Chinese study, it actually represents a spirit. Although it's not very common in Macau, but on mainland China, people would like to decorate their study like it was like in Song Dynasty in the past, so as to experience, to feel this spirit.
好啦，咁跟住落嚟啦，咁我哋都會開放一個提問環節啦。但由於時間關係咧，所以我哋今日咧就開放三條問題嘅。咁如果各位朋友有啲任何問題咧，都可以而家提出啊，或者一陣間我哋私下探討都可以嘅。
Now we'll move into our Q&A section, and as we just have limited time, we can only open for three questions.
Bye.
係晚安啊！多謝阿 Catherine 你解釋得好暢進。我想問一下咧，你頭先介紹咗咁多文房四寶嘅玩物啦，咁我想問一下，其實係咪一定作為一個文人雅士就一定會有齊曬咧？咁而而家當代嘅中國人啦，咁佢哋都好似頭先你所講，佢都模仿住好似以前。他們的書房是怎樣做，那他們又會具備了什麼條件去做呢？謝謝。
那以下我們提問環節，那我和馮先生都會一起進行的。多謝你的提問。
你說以前呢，那個是不是一定要，那個文人雅士喜歡的文房的呢？大部分都是，他自然呢，那些文人走在一起呢，佢自然會，大家都有嗰種嗜好，啊，嗰種玩意嚇，所以咧嚇，到現在以前又係咁，到現在有啲文人都係走在一起咧，畫畫啊，佢自己收藏啲咧文物文房嘅嘢啊，譬如啊玉器啊、雜項啊、嗰個 瓷器啊，都係帶有文房嘅角色多啲嘅嗰啲物品啊。
咁我都補充翻啦，其實咧唔一定要擁有曬所有嘅文房用品嘅，係啦，只不過佢哋其實文人雅士啦，都係對於佢哋嚟講，咁都係一件工具啦。佢哋有需要嘅話咧，佢哋會去使用啦。咁其實咧就唔一定話要齊曬先得嘅，只不過咧有啲人可能佢覺得。我去到呢個生活品位，我呢個層次嘅話咧，我真係想擁有曬所有嘅文房雅器集埋一齊喎。咁大家可能其他朋友會嚟我度傾偈噶嘛，因為以前佢哋都會飲茶咁樣，所以就會中意咧收集多啲唔同類型嘅文房雅器，而供大家去即係傾偈啊，或者飲茶啊，都可以有一個話題咯。但係你話係咪一定要擁有曬所有嘅嘢先叫做一個好嘅文房嘅收藏啊，或者呢個先至係叫做文房嘅精神？但係唔一定嘅，係個人喜好嚟嘅啫。
So the lady was asking, was it very common for all educated class or intelligent people to collect all of these stationery items? So the speakers answered that it was very common for them to collect these items because in the past, these intelligent people or scholars would like to gather together. So when they were together, so they also shared similar habits, which was collecting these scholarly or stationary items. And actually, these items were not only made in jade, but also made in other materials, for example, porcelain. So not every scholar would collect, but since they would go to each other's house to have gathering, so these items would become a topic and also could be used for them to appreciate. So it became common.
Okay, 我哋可以下一條問題。
好多謝 Catherine 同埋馮生嘅介紹啦，即係令到大家對於玉啦係一個非常之深嘅了解嘅。咁我嘅問題有兩個嘅，咁第一個咧就係我哋會見到啦，唔同嘅玉入邊咧個取材係嚟自於中國嘅傳統嘅文化啦，或者係傳統嘅故事嘅。咁中華文化上下五千年啦，咁發展到而家，其實即係中國歷史有好多嘢可以書寫噶。咁喺現代嘅嗰啲玉嘅雕刻嘅內容當中，會唔會加入啲新嘅內容咧？呢個第一個問題。第二個問題就係，因為都係由明代或者以前啲玉嘅嗰啲雕嘅手工藝啦，咁一直發展到而家現當代社會啦，喺一啲雕玉嘅技術方面啦，會唔會有啲新嘅發展，或者係會唔會嘗試同西方嘅聯繫，會唔會有啲交流啊，會有啲深化嘅藝術咁樣咧？係啦，就係呢兩個問題，唔該曬。
多謝你嘅提問。
好啦，我講。你話以前嗰個玉嗰個會唔會用依家嘅題材？即係依家題材會唔會有改變？肯定係會有嘅。唔同嘅時代咧，有唔同嘅文化背景，唔同嘅故事嚇，會有逐漸會改變嘅嚇。好啦，咁就玉，我哋中國就玉到依家係分為五個時期。第一個係新社時代啊，第二個係夏商周。到嗰個晚期，第三個時期係由嗰個周朝到嗰個戰國春秋中後期，好啦。第四個朝代就係嗰個由春秋後期隋唐至到清朝，直至到二十世紀60年代初，仲係用手工嘅手工藝嚇，用嗰個人手就力嘅。即係到60年代之後就有咗電動機械啦，啊嗰陣就唔使用手腳嚟比力啦，啊咁就我哋就後喺60年代之後就定咗一個係一個時期啦，到依家見到依家都係機械工啦，啊咁變咗就價值方面咧就由手工藝60年代之前嗰個價值觀念咧。同埋嗰個美感啦，手工嘅美感咧就比較大啲，就比較吸引玩古玉嘅人多啲。
So the lady was asking, as China has a culture of more than history of more than 5,000 years, so aside from traditional cultures and stories, would there be any new contents or new topics be used in carving these jade items? So our speaker answered, actually, in different times, different things happened. So when we talk about jade items, we can categorize them into five phases. The first was Neolithic age, and the second was from Xia dynasty to Zhou dynasty. The third was from Zhou dynasty to the three kingdoms dynasty, and then the fourth was from Sui dynasty to 1960s. So after 1960s, as we entered into the industrialization age, so machinery was used to make jade art and jade items. So actually the value also became lower. So actually before 1960s, the value of jade art actually was higher.
好，跟住最後一條問題， 由於時間關係。
Last question, please.
大家仲有沒有問題？
Hello， 我想問一下咧，其實點樣分一啲新嘅玉定係同埋舊嘅玉？咁譬如啱啱聽你講，可能啲玉係可能幾千年前嘅，到依家可能幾百年前嘅。咁幾千年前嘅玉會唔會啲色澤方面係有啲唔同，即係可能會亞啲色啊，或者會光亮啲？咁呢度想了解翻點樣去分辨。
多謝你嘅提問。OK，如果分新舊嘅玉咧，頭先我講咗有五個步驟啊嘛，如果係從第一個步驟，由嗰個新石器時代，基本上佢就用石係做陀工啊，用尖利嘅石啊、細嘅石啊，或者整到佢有尖鋭啲啊，做陀工嘅。好啦，到第二個時期就轉咗，開始進步啦。夏商周期咧，夏商周時期咧就有銅器啦。 咁銅器咧就又進步咗咯喎，又嚟咗啲咯，但係佢前期咧就黃銅嘅，到嗰個周朝嗰陣咧，差唔多咧就進化到青銅啦，又硬咗啲咯，又進步咗啲啦。咁佢啲工藝咧做出嚟咧，一個個唔同嘅工具做出嚟咧，係會有唔同嘅感覺嘅。呢個但係你需要去慢慢去分析嘅。好啦，第三個時期咧就到鐵陀工啦。 鐵陀工又更加堅硬咗啦，咁變咗咧，佢做嘅時間咧，做嘅速度咧又快咗啦。好啦，咁你要觀察佢鐵陀工嗰個工藝、那個旋轉率係有點樣，你要對比啦。咁你肯去每一個步驟去對比咧，就會對比到嘅。咁從呢幾方面啊，同埋嗰個玉，佢每一段嘅潤度咧唔一定，佢入土嘅時候咧，入木嘅時候咧，佢有可能濕啊、均啊。 都會有影響嘅，同埋咧全勢你玩得個耐，同埋冇乜點玩，又有一定嘅影響嘅嗰個量值啊，嗰個滋潤啊，所以咧就呢幾方面咧都要慢慢去了解，慢慢去多啲去接觸嘅。
So the gentleman was asking, how do we differentiate between older jade items and newer jade items? So if there's any difference in terms of their color. So the speaker answered, so it depends actually on the techniques used to abrade the jade. So for example, in the Neolithic era, so stone or sand were used to abrade jade. So it was rougher, I think, on the outside. And then when it came to Xia, Shang, Zhou dynasty, so bronze materials were used to abrade jade, so the techniques became better. Later in the third phase, iron wheels were used to abrade jade, so the techniques even became better. So you can actually look at the techniques used or the tools used to abrade jade and then to decide if it's older or newer. And actually, different times in the day would also affect the moisture of the jade, or how long you have touched or play with the jade would also affect the texture. So a lot of factors are involved.
多謝曬大家嘅問題啦。一陣間有時間，我哋都可以私下交流一下嘅。咁嚟到我哋講座嘅尾聲啦，咁喺度啦，都再一次感謝觀樂兒基金會啦，對我哋今次項目嘅支持啦。觀樂兒博士咧，本身都係一個文化愛好者啦，好多謝佢提供呢個平台俾我哋啦。咁其實咧，文房雅趣咧係我哋一系列嘅活動嚟嘅。我哋之前咧其實講過木器啦，今期講玉器，嚟緊咧我哋都會可能唔同材質咧都會開一個題材嘅，咁歡迎大家啦，都可以關注一下我哋嘅公眾號啦，或者加入我哋文房雅趣呢個群啦，大家互相交流嘅。咁喺度多謝大家今日出席我哋呢個講座。咁一陣間咧，我哋有一個咧文房上手嘅環節啦。咁大家咧都可以咧嚟我哋呢度有一個 setting， 就係我哋如當時即係文人雅士係點樣去放置嘅呢啲嘅文房用具啊。咁大家都可以上手啊，摸下玩下，拎住佢打卡影下相都 OK 嘅。
叫佢影埋相。
So our talk has come to an end. I really want to thank Rui Cunha Fan and Mr. Rui Cunha. He's also a culture lover. So I really want to thank him for providing us this platform. Actually, we are going to host a series of talks. Previously, we held talks on woodware. This time it's jadeware. So we are planning to host other talks about wares made from different materials. So you are encouraged to join our WeChat group and follow our WeChat account so that you can get more information about scholarly use items. And over there, you can see a deck with some jade objects. So you are welcome to come to this deck to look at and really feel these objects. So thank you, everyone.
好，我依家都
多謝曬，
影張
多謝大家今日出席，
影張答謝。
Thank you for your great support.
I'm very sorry, but I couldn't. 影張答。